I know we have a lot to get through. When we were getting ready for this presentation, my head was already exploding, so I want yours to do the same. I'm going to introduce our two really fantastic panelists. To my far, far right is Rick Aldrich. He's a professor. He has 20 years spent in at the Air Force JAG, specializing in cybercrime and information operations portfolios. He was recognized as an outstanding professor of law at the Air Force Academy. He's now part of Booz Allen's support of the DoD CIO. I always like to include a fun fact, because not only can he accomplish all these things in his day job, he has time to pursue stand-up paddle boarding. And a super fun thing I learned about Rick is that he was on a TV game show many years ago and won enough to take a big family vacation to Australia. So hats off to you. To my immediate right is Dr. Adriana Sanford. And I was overwhelmed, she's a professor at Pepperdine, that she has taught over 7,000 students and has some students with us today. So I think that's fantastic. You may have seen her. She's an international television commentator who appears regularly as a CNN analyst and contributor to over 49 million households. She's a global speaker with the American Programs Bureau and one of the keynote speakers for the 2019 Super Conference in Chicago, one of the largest conferences for in-house lawyers of Fortune 100 companies. And for anyone who's interested, it's in May this year. Her expertise is in global threats and laws at the international level. And important to note, and I know you'll be paying attention when you hear the presentations, possible outcomes for corporate non-compliance creates criminal liability and poses physical danger for executives and their in-house counsel in foreign territories. So my ears will be perked up. She has such an interesting background. She is Chilean, and is her DNA comes from one of the founding families in 1549. And to combine in that DNA, she's a first cousin, 10th removed to Benjamin Franklin. So, you know, I'm telling you, you have picked the right place to come. Now, as lawyers love to do, I'm gonna give you the fine print up front, and I do believe there's a slide. Each of our speakers are speaking on behalf of themselves and not with any organization they may represent. And as you all know, we're not giving legal advice, but we are giving you a lot of insight into what we know about what is happening right now. There's a ton to cover. If for some reason, I want people to feel free to be interactive, raise your hand if you have questions. I will be really militant about time because we've got a lot to get through. But there is a session tomorrow morning if you're up super early at 7 a.m. called Birds of a Feather. And you can also talk about more of some of these legal issues there and then. And also, as you leave, we have the SciTech Lawyer, which is an ABA publication, and the Carpenter case. There's an article with Professor Aldrich that is included in this issue. So it'll be at the back when you leave. So without any further ado, I'm going to pass it off to Professor Aldrich.
Okay, thank you very much. So I'm going to primarily be covering the domestic cases, and then I'm going to turn it over to my co-panelist, and she'll be covering the international cases. And I'm going to try to involve you in this as well. I'm going to ask you some questions, and I welcome your questions and response. Oops, now we can just move beyond this. Oh, there we go. Okay. Okay, so the first case I'm going to bring up is United States versus Toussaint. And in this case, an individual was making some small micropayments to certain countries using Zoom, X-O-O-M. And that piqued their curiosity because he was making these payments to countries that are known for sex trade. And usually when people apparently make small payments to countries in the sex trade, that oftentimes indicates bad issues. So he'd signed up for the Zoom service with a Yahoo account, so they alerted Yahoo. Yahoo did some checks on his email, and they found some what they believed to be some child porn. So they reported to NCMEC, the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, and also the Department of Homeland Security. So they were able to track him down, apparently through his passport, and figured out that he was coming back to the country through Atlanta. So they were there ready for him when he arrived. And when he arrived, they decided they wanted to check his electronic devices. So they actually did a forensic search of his devices and found what they believed to be also some child porn. They used that evidence to then search his house with a search warrant to obtain additional evidence. He was convicted on this evidence and he appeals. So the question on appeal is, was the search of him at the Atlanta airport without a search warrant, was that a violation of the Fourth Amendment? How many people think it was? How many people think it was not? Okay. Now, the first thing I have to alert you to is, for those who aren't attorneys, is the Fourth Amendment generally protects against, you know, your protects your privacy against unreasonable searches and seizures, but the Supreme Court has introduced several exceptions, and one is the border exception. And the border exception applies at all international airports if you're landing from international flight. So he does come under the border exception, but they didn't just do a casual search, they also did a forensic search. And although most of you said that it wasn't a problem, the courts are actually split on this issue, with some saying that if you do a forensic search, you actually have to have reasonable suspicion. So the next question is, did they have reasonable suspicion? So to remind you of the facts, Zoom had identified these micropayments. They reported to Yahoo, they reported to DHS. By the time it got reported up, those micropayments had occurred 1.5 years ago. So do you believe there's reasonable suspicion based on that, that he would still have child porn on his computer? How many think yes? How many think no? Okay, so there's a bigger split on that. And the courts are a little bit split on that too, although generally for child porn cases, the courts have adopted a perception, and this is based on law enforcement experience, that people who collect child porn tend never to delete it. So while 1.5 years might be stale and therefore not justify a search warrant in many cases, in child porn cases it does tend to. So in this case, the lower court said that the reasonable suspicion standard applied, but there was reasonable suspicion. That was held on the second court. And when it went to the 11th Circuit, they said the reasonable suspicion standard doesn't even apply. At a border, you can do whatever you want as long as it's not personally invasive. So if they decide to do a strip search or a body cavity search, then they need a warrant or some higher standard. But if they're just invading your computer, there's no invasive standard there. So they've split the circuits on that. The Fourth and the Ninth, California's in the Ninth Circuit, hold that you do have to have reasonable suspicion. Other circuits do not. So it's a little bit split there. Now, this didn't come up in this case, but I just thought it was interesting. If he had a cell phone, and that was one of the electronic devices, and it was locked, can the Border Patrol require you to give up your passphrase? How many think they can? How many think they cannot? Okay, you might be interested to learn that the 2018 border inspection manual says they can force you to give up your encryption passphrase. There are a lot of people that don't believe that, including several courts. This particular case has not come up in a court, but in several other cases where the police tried to force the revelation of a decryption key, the courts have said no, it raises a Fifth Amendment issue. So it's a self-incrimination issue. So what if instead of asking for your password, they just said, put your finger on the fingerprint reader? Is that a Fourth Amendment violation or a Fifth Amendment violation? How many think it is? One of the two. How many think it is not? Okay, generally the courts have held fingerprints, you do have no expectation of privacy. It might break down if they say, put the finger that opens your phone on the phone, then that might actually be a Fifth Amendment because you're telling them something. This is the finger that does. But if they just say, put all your fingers on until it opens, that probably most courts would say is not. And then finally, facial identification. How's that gonna play? Let's suppose the police just went up to you and they said, is this your phone? And you were looking at them and they're like, whoa, it just opened. Would that be legal? In most jurisdictions, there hasn't been a lot of case law, but they seem to believe you have no expectation of what your face looks like in public. Therefore, you have no expectation of privacy that it might not be opening phones. So obviously, Apple and I believe some of the other major carriers have created situations where you can hold the power button for a certain period of time, or you can do certain other things to revert it back to the passphrase required, or the PIN required, rather. So that kind of deals with those situations. The next case is the In Re Zappos case. Whoops, okay, we did that. Oh yeah, here. Oh, and the takeaway from that is if you have corporate IT, and you're moving across borders, you should really have a corporate IT policy, Because you should realize that in some jurisdictions, they don't even require reasonable suspicion. They can seize that, they can hold it for up to 5 days, and you know, you don't know what's gonna happen to your proprietary data during that time. So, you know, most companies, if you don't, this is one of the things I would recommend when you get back, check your corporate policy on that, make sure you have a corporate policy dealing with that. You should also tell your employees whether they should or should not give up their passphrase when asked, because they may actually be detained or actually denied entry to the country, so you should think about that in advance. Yes?
What happens if you don't remember your password, seriously?
Yes. they will give you several days in a detention facility to remember it, most likely. There have been some cases where a person did claim not to remember it, and if the judge didn't believe it, then the judge did put them in jail for contempt. And there was one guy, I believe he's been in jail for 18 months, and they say, no, we think you still know it. In other cases, the courts have held, well, you know, it took so long for this case to get up here, we believe that you may not remember it anymore. So it's kind of an up or down on that. Okay, the next case I'd like to talk about is In re Zappos, the online shoe retailer. In this case, some hackers breached Zappos' site. They stole names, account numbers, passwords, email addresses, billing and shipping addresses, telephone numbers, and credit card numbers on 24 million Zappos customers. So many of those customers chose to sue Zappos. At the time of their suit, there had been no persons who had their identity stolen or who had otherwise been taken advantage of based on that theft. So the question is there Article III standing? Article III standing requires generally that a person suffer an injury in fact. It can't just be speculative, it actually has to be an injury in fact. So based on that understanding, how many of you think that the people who are suing Zappos have standing? How many think they do not? Okay. Well, you'd be surprised to learn that this is also a place where the courts are a little bit split, but the majority opinion seems to be saying that they do have standing. And the rationale is that even with these large thefts of 24 million identities, that generally what criminals do with them, if it's in fact criminal and not just a nation state, but if it's criminals, they tend to put them on the dark web and sell them. And so there is a fairly substantial likelihood that you will suffer injury. And some have claimed that it is reasonable for people who have been, you know, the victims of such a breach to immediately purchase some type of identity protection or something like that, which means you've already suffered an injury because you've had to endure that. So again, I think from a perspective of a company, what you should do is you should realize that this does put you in a much potentially deeper situation where you might be sued, but I also think you can take some reasonable steps, like immediately notifying your customers and offering them free identity protection that will minimize the chances that they will suffer additional harm that they could claim right away, and it may help you. At least in some cases, being nice to your customers right after something like this happens might cause some of them not to sue you immediately. So, but again, realize that this case, there is standing now. So for any breach, you're now kind of hanging out there. So you might also want to consider other options at your disposal, something like even potential cyber insurance. Yes?
Yeah, I have a question. There is a growing suspicion that credit companies like Equifax and TransUnion may be selling to illegal and black market entities. Mm-hmm.
I haven't seen a lot of cases on it, but generally it comes down to the user agreement. So those things you click on as soon as you get anything new and you say, yes, I certify, I've read all this, a lot of times way down in the fine print it might say, I agree to allow the company to sell my information, whatever else, you know. It's way hidden down there under little things that says privacy rights, or even worse now what they're doing is they have one user agreement and they say, click here for the privacy agreement and click here for the privacy agreement applying to third parties and click here for, you know, so you really have to read a whole bunch of documentation. And so you'd really have to know, is it somewhere in there? And if it is, does a court think it's reasonable that you, having said, yes, I read it, would actually have read it or not, and whether you can be bound by that? Okay. And the other thing that was interesting about this case is the Supreme Court actually ruled in Clapper versus Amnesty International, and that was a case where some attorneys and their clients were suing the NSA, saying, hey, the NSA is just scooping up all this data that's going out of the country, and you know, we're attorneys, we're communicating with foreign clients, we could be subjected to that, especially in some cases our clients may not be the up-and-up trappy people, maybe the NSA is specifically interested in us. And in that case, the Supreme Court said, no, there's no Article III standing, too speculative. Now, you would think that would be controlling, because once the Supreme Court says something, all other lower courts are bound by it. But the lower courts have said, well, that was a national security issue. They went into a lot of the justifications as to how they don't want to second guess the national security intelligence officials. So the courts have narrowed that. And even the Supreme Court itself narrowed it somewhat in a later case where they basically said you have to have substantial likelihood of injury. Okay, there it is. Okay, the next case is Carpenter, and this is a very important case, one that came out of the Supreme Court just last year. The facts of this case are kind of interesting, because what basically happened was several people participated in some robberies of T-Mobile and Radio Shack. The first thing that surprised me is there are still Radio Shacks out there. I did not realize that, but in any event, maybe these people helped bring them down. They did it over a period of 4 months, and the police were having some difficulty finding the perpetrators. They eventually arrested four people that they suspected. One of them actually confessed and agreed to give up his phone to the FBI. The FBI took the phone, looked in it, and determined all of his contacts. Based on those contacts, they took some of those people and they went to the local phone provider, wireless provider, and said, we want this individual's location history, cell site location information, for the last 127 days. In other words, where was he at all points during that period? Why the 127 days? Because that covered the span of the robberies. There was one individual, Carpenter, who came up actually very physically close to all the robbery locations during their period in question. They used that evidence against him at trial. He was tried, convicted, and sentenced to 116 years. So he appeals and says, it was illegitimate and a violation of my Fourth Amendment rights for you to obtain that information from my wireless provider without a warrant. They used a court order, but they did not use a warrant. How many of you think that this way of obtaining the cell site location information is valid? How many think it's a violation of the Fourth Amendment? Okay. Some of you aren't voting already. You missed a few and you've given up. You're like this. I don't think so. Okay. Okay, be bold. Okay, so the question is a warrantless search and seizure of the cell site location a violation of the Fourth Amendment? And basically what the court held is that the Sixth Circuit, which is where it went first, they said, no, it's not a violation of the Fourth Amendment. And I just want to run through their analysis first to show how significant the Supreme Court's decision was. They said, well, first of all, the law only protects content, not transactional information. So the fact that you are doing some transactions with your phone is not the same as intercepting your phone conversations, and so that's not a big deal. Secondly, they said you gave this information to a third party, okay? When you generally give information to a third party, you have a much lower expectation of privacy. If I have a diary that I want to keep secret and I say, hey, would you hold this diary for me, but don't give it to anyone? And they said, oh no, I'll never give it to anyone. But then they read it and they're like, oh my God, this is horrible. And they run to the police. Can the police use that diary? Yes. But they promised me they wouldn't give it to anybody. Doesn't matter, the courts have said. Once you give it to a third party, you have a lowered expectation of privacy, and you run the risk that someone might take that to the police. So their second rationale was, look, you gave this information to the carrier. You basically were pinging away with your phone, you know, hitting all the nearby cell towers, and you were basically saying, yeah, I consent to you finding me, I consent to you finding me. Now, how many of you think that that's really what people think? I think a lot of people don't even know their technology, and if they did, they certainly don't think that as they're walking around, they're constantly consenting to this. Nevertheless, that raised an interesting issue, because if it is third-party covered by the third-party doctrine, there's a big loss here. Next, the court said the Jones case doesn't really apply. Jones was a case out of the D.C. area where an individual was suspected of being a drug dealer, and they wanted to follow him around to make sure that his travels actually coincided with drug deals. So they got a search warrant to apply a GPS device to his car and then to monitor him for 30 days. The application was in the District of Columbia where they could do this. Unfortunately, he parked across the district line and they put it on in Maryland and they put it on after the 30 days had already expired. So when they get to court, they have all this great evidence, but he moves to suppress it, and the government now has to defend it. So they said, well, we really didn't even need this warrant anyway, because he was traveling on public streets. You have no expectation of privacy in travel on public streets. Now, how did you think the court ruled in that case? Well, the Supreme Court said, yes, you may, because the cell site location information, excuse me, the GPS information they gained from that allowed them to dramatically change the context of the Fourth Amendment. So the government said, well, wait a minute, we could have stationed policemen at each corner, we could have secretly followed them, we could have done all this stuff, and there'd be no expectation of privacy, and we wouldn't have to get a search warrant for that. And the court said, that's true. But you would only do that in super, super important cases, not in every case. And this GPS device makes it too easy for you to find anyone, anytime, for virtually no cost. Now, what's the difference between Jones and the Carpenter case? In Jones, the government installed it. In Carpenter, you're giving it away to your third-party provider. So again, they say it doesn't matter. And the next case is Riley. And Riley, the Sixth Circuit said, doesn't apply. Riley was a case where an individual was arrested, and pursuant to that arrest, they searched him, and they found a cell phone on him. So they opened up the cell phone, they started going through all the contents of it. And he's like, wait a minute, you shouldn't be able to do that. And they said, search incident to lawful arrest, another exception to the Fourth Amendment. So it got all the way appealed to the United States Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court said, well, cell phones are different. They're not like, a piece of paper or a cigarette box or, a piece of, some drugs or anything else. Generally, the justification for search incident to arrest is protection of the police officers or avoiding the destruction of evidence, okay? So the government said, well, he could have destroyed the evidence. We seized the phone, but how do we know he's not going to run home and remotely delete his whole the contents of his phone? And the court said, well, put it in a Faraday bag or something like that. You have other options. We're not going to let you go through the whole phone just for that. So in those two cases, Jones and Riley, they started recognizing that computer and modern technologies are shifting the Fourth Amendment to where we would have no protection. So they were kind of doing an equilibrium adjustment to bring it back. And in this case, the court did the same. So they, in spite of what the Sixth Circuit held, they said no. Although this case is at the intersection of all of those, we believe that the mass sharing of information like this, your cell site location information with your provider, is qualitatively and quantitatively different than the normal third-party exception. So while we're not going to strike down the third-party exception, we're going to say, at least with regard to cell site location information, in all future cases, the government must get a warrant. Now, let's see. What the court said that they weren't ruling on is stingrays, tower dumps, or conventional techniques such as security cameras. So let's analyze those. What is a stingray? Stingray is where the government puts up a fake cell tower with a strong enough signal that your phone's going to say, oh, that's the strongest signal, and you're going to connect it through it, and you're going to do all your transactions through that. Why do police do this? This gives them a lot of inside information that generally only your provider would have. How many of you think that the court would uphold the use of stingrays without a search warrant? How many think that they do require a search warrant? Okay. In most jurisdictions, they're going to start requiring them. Many states have passed laws requiring it. The Department of Justice and the Department of Homeland Security have put in their guidelines, you should always get a search warrant before doing stingray use. So, but there are still some states that have not, and it hasn't been a definitively ruled on issue yet. What about tower dumps? Tower dumps are where the government knows that, this bank was robbed, but they have no clue who might have robbed the bank. But there's a cell tower nearby. So they go to the phone company and they say, tell us every phone that connected to the cell tower, like an hour before, an hour after the robbery, so that we can get a list of potential suspects and then we'll do the legwork from there. How many of you think a cell tower dump would be allowed without a search warrant? How many think it would require a search warrant? Okay, this is another open question, but most people think, especially based on the holding of Carpenter, that this is the paradigmatic case for where a search warrant would be required, because you're imposing this, lowering of expectation of privacy and the searching of every innocent person who happens to pass through there on a large scale and without a warrant. So some people are saying this seems to be the type of case that you would. And then finally, the conventional techniques such as security cameras. I don't know if you know, but the Smollett case, obviously they were able to find some potential perpetrators in that very quickly. Because what? They had a bunch of security cameras all around, and the government also cooperated with store owners. Apparently, they had some kind of a deal that if you agreed to share your video footage with them upon demand, they would provide some type of compensation or something in return for that privilege. So based on that, they were able to find Smollett's perpetrators fairly quickly. Similarly, in New York, they have an even more extensive situation. It's all government-owned, but they have cameras all around the city. Plus, they've tied it into facial recognition software and license plate readers. So whenever a bomb goes off in New York, they can go back through their data and say, okay, who was near there, you know, for, you know, extended period of time? What were the, what was their license plates if they're driving? What was their face? You know, who does that relate to? Everything else. Whether this is what the court meant by conventional techniques such as security cameras, I don't know, but I would suggest that this transformational use of security cameras may raise some issues under the Fourth Amendment as well. Now, it may be that the government uses a different analogy. Maybe they'll say exigent circumstances. We had a bomb go off. There's a bomber loose. We need to get this bomber. Exigent circumstances would also be a potential way to circumvent the Fourth Amendment. But if they don't have that, there may be a Fourth Amendment issue that we have to look at more closely. Okay. And then the last thing, because I knew I wasn't going to have too much time, is I wanted to just, oh, yes. So, oh, and the takeaway from this is if your company collects sensitive data, consider how you're making a user agreement with your customers. Let's suppose you have an app, one of those apps that says, you know, will you let us keep your GPS data on all the time you're going so that we can alert you to sales whenever you happen to walk by one of our stores or one of our competitors or whatever else. And some people said, yeah, sure. Well, now they have a ton of potential data on everywhere you've traveled. What would happen if your company, having that information, was approached by the FBI and said, hey, look, we're going to give you either voluntarily give it to us or we're going to give you a court order to surrender it to us? Would you oppose that or would you cooperate with it? Okay. I guess it depends on what your company procedure is, but a lot of companies may not want to be known as the app that the FBI always goes to capture you. So if that's the case, then what you might want to do is put in your user agreement, look, we're only going to use this for a certain period of time. We will delete it very quickly. You still have an expectation of privacy, things like that, so that when the FBI comes, you can say, gee, we'd like to, but we don't really consider this to be information to which they gave us for that purpose, and we're going to demand a Fourth Amendment search warrant. Now, whether that works or not, we don't know, but you might just want to think about that, because if you you hold that much information, you're going to be a target when they're looking for someone to use that information on them. Okay, and then I think I just want to go to a real quick review on some other cases that were interesting, I thought, but which I didn't think I would have enough time because I'm going to keep pumping here. Okay, so cyber insurance. This case is still pending, but Mondelez versus Zurich American Institute. Mondelez is a very big snack company. They make Nabisco, Oreo, Belvita, others. They apparently have 165 locations. Well, they're in 165 countries. They're a lot more than that locations. And during the NotPetya outbreak, they had 24,000 laptops bricked, 1,700 servers bricked, okay? So they lost about $100 million in damage, suffered $100 million in damage due to that. So they were thinking, well, thank God we took out that insurance policy with Zurich American Insurance. And they went to Zurich and said, hey, we need to cash in on our insurance policy. At first, apparently, Zurich was saying, okay, yeah, no problem, you know, fill out all this paperwork, details, you know, tell us exactly where these laptops were and everything else. After they did that fairly extensive review, then Zurich said, well, you know, if we give you 10, then they weren't paying out immediately. So Mondelez said, look, if you don't pay us out immediately, we're going to sue. And so Zurich said, well, we'll give you $10 million not to sue immediately. We just need to clarify some things. And then after a period of time, Mondelez ran out of patience and they sued Zurich. Now Zurich is claiming, well, it falls actually under the wartime exception because a lot of countries thought NotPetya was perpetrated by a nation state. And so if it's a nation state action, then under our particular clause, even though you had an all perils coverage, there's an exception that says not whenever an act of war is perpetrated by a country or their surrogates, whether it's a real war or just seems like a war, we're not covering you. And so now this is kind of interesting, especially because right at the time that NotPetya came out, Zurich ran a bunch of commercials. Hopefully there's no one in Zurich here, but they ran a bunch of commercials that said, you know, this is the type of thing that we help you with, these unexpected emergencies like NotPetya and things like that. So it looked like they were trying to encourage everyone to get insured for this event that they would never pay on. So Interesting case. We'll have to see how it comes out. Oops. Okay. Let me just run real quickly. Private cloud. Reddick, basically what they said there is Microsoft did an automatic search of everything you put up in the cloud. If it matched a hash value of known child porn, they said, we're going to report it. They did. The government obtained the files without a search warrant. They said, too bad. You so sad. Because Microsoft already did this hash search on it, they frustrated any expectation of privacy you had. Biometrics, a judge actually said, when the government submitted a search warrant and said, we want not only to seize a bunch of devices at this location, but everyone who's there, we want to have them submit their biometrics so we can open all the devices. She said, I'm not going to give a search warrant for that. That's too far. That's going against the Fourth and Fifth Amendment. Her rationale is not very good, but it's an interesting case. And then the CFAA, basically, I'm not going to cover that because it's too complicated. So thank you very much.
I need to stand. Can everybody hear me? So what just happened here? That was great. What he put together was something that you were writing down. And you guys are getting ready. You were raising your hand. You were giving opinions. And everybody had an opinion. And at the end, he gave you an answer. And you wrote that down. This is really, really important because you guys are all professionals. We have CISOs. We have lawyers and other professionals that are here today, that are here with RSA, to collaborate and to get answers. Non-compliance, that's not something that comes to mind for most of you. That's why you're here. You went to school. If you went to law school, I went 6 years. I have JD and two LLMs. In international comparative law, that was my focus. Like Rick here, I have answers. And if you are a professional and you went to school, you're used to that. You're used to formulas. You get your strategic plan together and you present it to your CEO, to your board, to your boss. You have industry standards. You join together. You navigate your way through the GDPR, now the CCPA. What are we going to do? What does reasonable mean? Reasonable measures, right? That might be a legalese, right? Reasonable, the word reasonable. If you're a lawyer, that triggers something, especially if you're in this country. Appropriate measures is what we're using for GDPR. So you know what I've heard a lot of you guys say? Reasonable, appropriate measures, or appropriate, reasonable. That sounds really, really good, you guys. And some of you are going to get together out here, and you're going to start talking about this and creating new standards and going forward. That's great when you're in this country. And if we're dealing with reasonable standards, we heard 20 controls might be reasonable. And if nothing else, the regulators are going to take a look and realize that you tried to mitigate your risks, that you were doing something, and they may actually be okay with that. But I'm not here to talk to you about the domestic side. International, multi-jurisdictional concerns is totally, totally different. This is as if water has spilled out of your bathtub and you've got a towel and you're cleaning it up and all of a sudden it's going in another direction. That's what's happening on the international side. And while you may train for CCPA and GDPR, guess what? In Europe, countries can tweak it. Okay, so you're ready for that. You back up and you say, we're going to take another look, we're going to be transparent, we're going to go ahead and inform, we're going to make sure we get that consent, not the consent that Rick was talking about where you asked and he said, well, there's a fine line in this and the judge may decide. That's not going to work over there, we know that. We've seen Google and we've seen Facebook have some issues. But we're not even talking about that because you know what, there are variations of the GDPR too. and then there are landmark rulings in other countries, and they may have a different framework. Okay, so I put all this out here. We've got local legislation, right? Domestic. We have regional legislation. We have international issues out there. But there's something else that we have. What we talked about was noncompliance. The issue is, even when you have the right lawyers and the right people on your team, the laws in the international arena conflict and compete with one another. So the global risk, the financial impact, the legal consequences, as you start filling this out, you start to realize, depending on the region, the jurisdictions that you're doing business, depending on your industry, it varies. We have a lot of individuals out here. We have a lot of consultants, third parties, that are talking about helping you to organize your data, to collect your data, and giving you the pitfalls of who owns your data, where is it located, right? And they're gonna help you manage this. Because some of your companies are not complex enough to be able to handle it, so you've got other individuals that can do that. I'm gonna throw something else out there though. Those companies look at this as global, and they deal with global. We can't deal with global anymore. What we need is global. Those of you who took marketing understand what the word global means. In the same way that you market to a global environment, it's the same thing when we're talking about laws today. My area of expertise is global threats. Money laundering, counterfeiting, human trafficking in the supply chain, and of course cyber. Cybersecurity for the last decade. If you're going to clean house, you need to look at all of these issues. Not just cybersecurity. So let's take a look at some of the areas that are hot, and I'll show you how these areas, you can use it in one country, but not in another. We need to be global. In France, Google was hit with a $57 million fine. This is a big deal. We're dealing here with GDPR. GDPR is going to be one of your issues, not the only issue. Planned obsolescence, defamation. There's a whole bunch of different issues that are going to be popping up, and depending where you're located, depending on your jurisdiction, it's going to be addressed different ways. For those of you who are in France or who understand a little bit about France, you may know this. France's privacy law even makes it illegal to take pictures of your children, your own children, and put them on the internet. You can go to jail, depending on the photos. Your child can also sue you for those photos, for putting them up. So take a look at that. The way that France is going to deal with privacy is going to be more restrictive than some other countries in Europe, and they're allowed to tweak. So we had Google have a situation there, basically because the court felt that in this particular case, the consent was forced. You really had no choice. If you wanted to continue, you had to, the fine print and everything, you basically were not given a choice, is what they said. If we take a look at Germany, Facebook had an issue. What was Facebook's issue? Was the way they were collecting the data. It was not only the data from Facebook, but they were collecting it from WhatsApp, from Instagram, and from other third parties through cookies. Okay, so now you understand that maybe you don't want to do that. In this particular case, the government was saying, this is like a monopoly. You're just taking over and you're collecting in different ways. We need to be very, very careful. So you kind of understand a little bit about what's going on here, but let's take a look at bulk data collection. That's something that came up, the Snoopers Charter in the UK. Well, if you think about it, most of Europe is Napoleonic law. UK is common law. The way they looked at it is, okay, you know what? We are going to do surveillance, and we've got the Snoopers Charter, and we want you to collect your data, and we want you to keep that data for a year. Well, what happened was the rest of the EU said no. The European Court on Human Rights said that is a violation of human rights. They said that the mass surveillance and intelligence sharing did not violate international law, but that bulk data collection was an issue. Well, this is a concern for you guys, because if it goes through and you have to do this, remember what we've been telling you in other sessions, that you don't want to hold on to data that you don't need anymore, that you want to let it go, and we're trying to maneuver and tell you, you know, who owns your data and all this stuff. Well, this might put a little bit of a wrinkle in there if some countries, maybe this one, they'll change it, but what if there's another country out there that requires this for you? The right to be forgotten. That's a concept that a lot of you are talking about, and you think, okay, fine, I got the concept. The problem is that there's so much involved here. So what is appropriate depends on the country. When we look at Google, what happened here? Here there was a case of an individual, a businessman, that actually had a criminal record. But that criminal record was 10 years old. And Google answered and said, hey, you did something wrong, it's out there. We're not going to remove it. What did the court say? The court said, you know what, he suffered enough, he's changed his ways, remove it. So what does this do? This is huge. You know why? Because it means case by case by case by case, they're looking at the right to be forgotten. Do you know how many cases there are? Do you know how many people are going to want Facebook, Google, and all these companies to delete their information, especially now that they know they're going to look at them case by case? This is going to be huge for the courts. It's going to be huge for the companies. One example of right to be forgotten and how one country is dealing with that right. It's a lot more than just this, though, because another case was defamation. Germany, somebody sued under the right to be forgotten, and basically it was that you could find information about them through Google in search engines. In that case, Germany said, no, Google doesn't have to go through and fix that, right? Germany said that. Guess what Australia said? Because remember, we're not just talking Europe. Australia, similar case, said you're responsible, you have to delete it. So this is why I'm telling you, these concepts and these policies that you've created, look at where you're doing business. And unfortunately, if you're doing business in a lot of places, these laws will conflict. These are open-ended situations where you will go back to your board and you'll say, you know what, there is no right answer. Here's one law, here's another law, we need to decide what to do. Now, probably what you want to do is you want to see where are the criminal penalties. Where might your executives go to jail? That might be one of your first priorities. And it will also be, it will always be a shuffling of ethical priorities, because ethical rules will vary. And you as an individual are going to have to decide which laws to break. Noncompliance. What's noncompliance going to cost me? Am I going to be sanctioned in one country? India. I put this one in here. This is important, even though it's a little older, 2017. It's important because it shows us India went in a different direction. India is the largest democracy in the world, and they just said fundamental right to privacy. Countries around the world are having a fundamental right to privacy, and they are going to create laws that will impact us. Far-reaching laws, extraterritorial reach. That's something we all know and are aware of today. Now, the issue here is outsourcing, right? Biometrics. The Aadhaar system is used by probably, I don't know if it's 1.2 billion people. It started off to be used just for welfare and for giving benefits to the poor in remote locations where some of these individuals didn't have the ability to document. But it worked so well, and it was a rapid rollout. And in 8 years, now you can use it for school, for opening accounts, for just about everything there. It takes your eye scan, your irises, your fingerprints, and whatnot. But the problem is it's being used, and our tech companies were using it and thinking this is great and creating programs for this. And all of a sudden, we got hit with a landmark ruling saying, heads up, we got to deal with this. I'm throwing this one in here because we talked about appropriate measures, reasonableness. Did any of you think that within reasonableness, we have to think about those executives and those employees that actually have a clearance, that actually are involved in our private data and have a job to protect that, may turn rogue? That's what happened here. It was an individual who actually had the responsibility to have that data. And that individual decided to hurt the company by having a breach. Well, you would say, well, wait a second. That wasn't us, right? But now you have to even plan for that. Remember when we first talked about data breaches and we said you need to look at your top 25 suppliers and make sure that they're compliant? And guess what? The cyber criminals realized you were only going there and that the other ones were not on your radar. So today you have to go up and down and you've got to get everybody, all your suppliers, all your third parties, all your vendors. Well, the same thing here. These are thoughts, these are concepts that perhaps we haven't even thought about yet. Vicarious liability for your rogue employees. How are you going to protect yourself if the person that you've put in that position decides to hurt you? In this particular case, that rogue employee actually won. This is exactly what he wanted to do, and guess what? The court said, you know, that it doesn't really seem fair. But these are some of the things we need to think about. And these are going to be uploaded, I know, somewhere. Some of you are taking pictures. You'll be able to find them later. Okay, here, repeated pattern of online defamation cases. I mentioned Australia before, and I'm mentioning it again, because here is something else you would never guess. Autocomplete. You know when you start putting your name in there, and it says all this wonderful stuff? For this particular individual, this person was involved in something and he got shot, and somehow in the autocomplete, when you put his name in, it said tied to the criminals, tied to the underworld. He was not tied, but this is what kept coming up, so he sued. And of course, Google was thinking, well, wait, how are we responsible for what comes up in autocomplete? You are. Again, is this something you were even thinking about? We don't know what's going to happen in this case. All we know is that the court has said you may go forward with this lawsuit. And this is just a trivia question. This is if this makes good conversation. If you happen to be going through New Zealand, guess what? You can be searched. The same thing with Canada. People know this. I've talked to people that have been in the airport and they said, actually, it's not a big deal. A lot of people are not searched, but they do have a right to search. The digital search is happening there, and we're gonna see more of that happening. And what I wanna stress on you guys is you're listening to this and you're realizing, okay, this is maybe bigger than we thought, but it goes further than this. And I'll just give you a little snip of that because I know my time's running out. We have something called Kathy's Quandary. 2004, we realized we had a situation. The lawyers did. It was called Kathy's Quandary. If you Google it, you'll find it. Kathy's Quandary is the way attorneys in this country deal with multi-jurisdictional practices. And it says basically that multi-jurisdictional practices, you've got legal dilemmas. You may not know how to solve certain issues. Fast forward, Kathy's Quandary, all of a sudden you start seeing articles on continuing Kathy's Quandary. I'm like 2008, 2009, continuing Kathy's Quandary. What I'm saying is forever Kathy's Quandary. How are we going to deal with this? How are we going to deal with the attorney-client privilege in this country where we have an attorney-client privilege? We are in-house lawyers. We deal with money laundering. We deal with fraud. I'm very good at my job. And guess what? I want to live in another country. So after 10 years, he comes to me with his issues within the company. I'm very good at handling the money laundering issues. And now you've moved me. Let's say you've moved me to Spain. You've moved me overseas. I'm excited about that move. Guess what? Other countries in other parts of the world don't have the attorney-client privilege the way we do in the United States. In-house lawyers wear many hats. And if we happen to have money laundering dealing with that country, that in-house lawyer is treated like a regular employee and must disclose. Well, your company didn't know that when they decided to send you. The person who just gave you more information had no idea, and now you have to disclose or you can face criminal liability. So what do we want to do? Do we want to have a sanction in the United States, or do we want to have criminal liability? But it doesn't stop there, because you know what? All of a sudden, something you didn't know, your company didn't know, and other people know that you need to disclose. And that's where the physical safety comes in. When you're in foreign territories and you've got information, and you didn't realize that you need to disclose it, but other people do, it can put you in dangerous situations. So we need to deal with Kathy's quandary. We need to deal with GDPR. We need to deal with all of these issues. I hope that we have federal legislation. I hope that we have global legislation. But in the meantime, what I will leave you with is, you've heard many times, be ethical. Be ethical when nobody's watching. I got a better one for you. Will you be ethical when it puts you into trouble? Or will you walk away and say, you know what? This situation is too difficult. We have global threats. I need you guys to realize the importance of those global threats and that you play a part in that. And to be ethical, even when there's conflicts between laws, don't walk away. And that's the hardest thing to do. Yeah, this you guys can look up later. There's planned obsolescence that creates criminal liability. There's Brazil. Brazil actually arrested an executive for Facebook, which had nothing to do with Facebook. You guys can look that up. You can find this. And we need to do the takeaway because I've taken too long. Rick?
Sure. Okay, so just to make sure that you understand the importance, when you go back to your organization, make sure you check your policies on transporting electronic files, identify what your company's contracts are with your cloud providers, with your insurance providers. Make sure that all the legal issues have been resolved to the best your extent possible. So I'll go ahead, because I know we have like 30 seconds, so I'll let you go through some of yours too.
This is basically a checklist. Make sure that you understand where your third parties are located, your suppliers, customers, and whatnot. Remember, we want to do local. And your general counsel, you guys, if you're out there, don't rely on your general counsel. He may slip up. Laws change all the time. So you need to know what your laws are in those countries. Discuss the complexities of open-ended situations with your senior management and decide how you want to handle it. What are the repercussions? So many people out there are losing their jobs, and it's not their fault. If you're in banking and you're in compliance, all of a sudden your life is on the line, and you're like, oh my gosh, I'm going to lose my job, and it's not your fault. I'm on CNN, and I talk about breaking news. I talk about Apple. I talk about Google. I talk about Facebook, and I'm like, okay, it's not their fault. Let's go back and discuss what's going on here. Because people are very fast to judge without realizing sometimes you gotta make a decision, and the decision is, what's the best decision in this situation? I gotta stop.
Okay, I wanna thank both of our panelists. Obviously, we're probably equal parts excited and scared, but let's leave that we all have job security for quite some time. Thanks so much.